Answered. Hey, everybody. Adam Savage in my cave, and I am taking MythBuster questions that have been submitted by tested patrons, and I'm answering them. And today's question comes from Steve B. Steve B says, in the early seasons of MythBusters, one of my favorite parts of each episode was where you would give a percent chance of what you thought could happen in any given test. That went away as the show progressed, and is there a reason for that? Yes, it did go away, and yes, there is a reason. And the reason is I like the... I'm a storyteller. That's been my primary occupation, these many years. It took me a long time to realize that was my occupation. But as a storyteller, I like keeping the story interesting. I like narrative beats that gather your attention, coalesce the information you've thus far been exposed to, and help you understand where things might be going or subvert where you think things might be going. So I came up with, in the very first season, this convention of like, all right, I think there's a 10% chance it's going to work, a 40% chance that all hell's going to break loose, and a 70% chance. And I would always try and make these numbers equal 100%. And at a certain point, I realized I keep banging into this thing. This was a gift from somebody. This is a steel cutout of my face. I'm leaning it up against my anvil here, but I keep bumping it and it's bothering me, so I'm gonna move it. There we go. Where was I? Right, I would try and come up with like four or five things that were funny and weird, and I give them percentages and I try and get those percentages to match up. And then I realized that there was nothing. Are you giving percentage or are you giving odds? Those are two different questions. And I was kind of conflating the two concepts. And then by making them add up to 100%, what I felt like what I was doing was I was giving people bad ways to think about statistics. And in this current world, in this reality, we don't need anyone making statistics less clear. They're already a dark science of mental manipulation that has no bottom. And so I was basically, I felt like I was reducing the quality of the discussion about statistics with my joke. What is that sound? This is another thing that's leaning up over here. Anyway. Yeah, I also got tired of the joke. I mean, that also happens. You do something 30 times and you're like, I'd like to think of a new way to do something. Which is its own sort of spiral you can get down, because maybe there are some things you shouldn't abandon, even though you feel like you've overdone them. Yeah. So that's why those went away. I'm thinking through this. I'm just trying to see if there's anything I've forgotten here. I will also say that was a fun convention, but what it led to was a much more structured convention where, as we filmed sequences, our producer, which for the longest time was Alice Dallow, would pull us aside and say, okay, you're just about to build the experiment. You're just about to build the methodology. What do you think is going to happen? And what do you think could happen? And what do, if A or B or C could happen, what do each of those mean for the experiment? And then once you're in it, you've got it built. Okay, you've got the experiment built. How do you think the build went? How do you think it's going? How do you think it's going to go? Okay, now it's built and you've experimented with it. What just happened? How do you feel about it? How does that lead you to the next thing? So with each narrative beat, Jamie and I would answer a ton of questions on camera, lots of redundant questions about what we thought was happening, was going to happen, what we thought about what was going to happen, and what we predicted. And what that allowed the editors to do was kind of take each narrative beat, and then we had some framing discussion around each narrative beat. It got tiring at times. I mean, I remember in Penny Drop, sorry, nope, in Bullet Drop versus Fired, which was an experiment where we had 2 complete days just to adjust the rig. And then on the 3rd or 4th day, on the final day that we were filming, we got what we wanted. We got the bullet skipping off the ground at the same instant the bullet hit the ground. We got that shot at about 1 in the afternoon. But in order to button down that story, we recorded pieces to camera for another 3.5 hours. And again, this is, in reality television, you can't be sure you always know what the story is in the field. And so you want to make sure you've given the editor, the editorial team, the producer and the editor, enough to work with whatever has happened in the field. That's a really, really good tip, because based on what we shot, the editors could cut multiple different kinds of stories. And sometimes there were narrative beats, like, you know, you may have this narrative beat of like deciding on the color of the thing that you're painting. And there's a whole discussion you film of talking about the color, of going to get the color and painting it. And you cut that whole sequence and it's going great. But then on 2 days later, maybe 300 goats wander on the set. And that's way funnier as a narrative beat in the story. So you cut in a little sequence about the goats showing up and the goats going away. And now you don't have time for the color discussion. That's an example of how stuff ends up on the cutting room floor. So to be sure, the stuff that ends up on the cutting room floor is just often slightly less interesting than whatever was replacing it. That's usually the equation you look for. Like, what are the best beats? Let's put those in. Yeah, there's some perspective in how we filmed that stuff. I appreciate the question. It's funny, no one else has ever asked me about the percentages in all this time. Steve V, thank you for being the first. That was delightful. Tested patrons, keep submitting your awesome questions and I will continue to answer them. Stay safe, everybody, and I will see you next time. Bye.